Good morning. Good to see you. Welcome to First Presbyterian. Woo! Christy's giving a hoop and a holler. The First Presbyterian on this Palm Sunday. You know, the whole Easter story is unfolding this week, and the despair of Good Friday will end in the celebration of a risen Savior next Sunday. And we hope that you'll be able to join us for that. I want to give a shout out to all the new visitors and to those that are watching online, to our friends that tune in and watch at different times during the week. It's great to have you with us. Could you please fill in your connection cards and leave it with your offering in the box at the door as you leave? We just keep seeing our ministry growing day by day here, and your support is helping us to do more and to make a difference in this city, so it's fantastic. This Thursday is our Living Last Supper. We've been announcing that for a long time, and that's finally here. And that'll be on Thursday, April 14th, in the gym at 6 p.m. We have over 100 people booked, so it's really exciting and really good. If something, you know, if your mind goes, oh, I never got the opportunity to sign up for that, and you want to do that, please let us know before you leave today or call Rita first thing on Monday. Because we might have to buy an extra chicken or two, all right? That's just all it is. So you'd be more than welcome to be there. We said last week we're starting this process of having a Stephen's ministry here. And again, if that's something that you're interested in, you'll hear more in the coming weeks. But Stephen's ministry equips people for the work of ministry in the church here. And we're really excited about this possibility. So please talk to, we've had a number of people have talked to Christy and I already about that. Today, as you leave, you'll be given one of these little envelopes. It's one great hour of sharing. Basically, it's for disaster relief, and if you can spur any cash to put in that or a check, we will take those in next Sunday at our three services on Easter Sunday. We're hoping that you'll make it a priority to be here on Easter Sunday to celebrate what we call the greatest day in history. We'll have a breakfast, so we're going to ask you, as soon as the service is over, we're going to go down next week, not this time. Next week, we're going to release butterflies down there. But we have breakfast in the fellowship hall, so please come down, and we can eat together and share a good time there. We will be doing the flooring of the cross. We'll be releasing butterflies. We're going to have Easter egg hunts for the kids upstairs in the maze of rooms up on the third floor, which will be fun with Cassandra. So please invite others. Let's fill the church as we worship the risen Savior. It's really exciting. It's the greatest time in the history of the church and the history of the world. Let's just watch this video. Let's stand. We'll sing Hosanna. Praise is rising.
Rising, eyes are turning.
up sometimes in the whole Easter, you know, and we're hunting for eggs and we're eating chocolate and we're having a great time. We forget that this was God's great rescue story, God's great mission to come to save the world. This song is called Rescue Story. Sandra's going to come and read our scripture.
Our scripture passage today comes to us from Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 11, from the Message. When they were nearing Jerusalem, at Bethphage and Bethany on Mount Olives, he sent off two of the disciples with instructions. Go to the village across from you. As soon as you enter it, you'll find a colt tethered, one that has never yet been ridden. untie it and bring it. If anyone asks, what are you doing? Say, the master needs him and will return him right away. They went and found a colt tied to a door at the street corner and untied it. Some of those standing there said, what are you doing untying that colt? The disciples replied exactly as Jesus had instructed them, and the people let them alone. They brought the colt to Jesus, spread their coats on it, and he mounted. The people gave him a wonderful welcome, some throwing their coats on the street, others spreading out rushes they had cut in the fields, rushing ahead and following after. They were calling out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in God's name. Bless the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. He entered Jerusalem, then entered the temple. He looked around, taking it all in. But by now it was late, so he went back to Bethany with the 12.
I confess that on the road to Jerusalem, I don't know where in the crowd I might have stood. Did I throw my coat in honor or wave my palm branch in celebration? Did I lead the crowd in shouts of worship or stand in the back and just watch? I only know that your love chases and weeps. Your love celebrates, forgives, and walks the long road with me. Even when I leave you behind in the dust, your love endures. Not just the goodness, but also the pain and the mistakes. I cannot explain even a moment that I forsake the opportunity to worship you. But today, I fall on my knees. I lay down the coat of my shame and sin. I wave my palm branch of surrender. I declare that you are God. There is no other. And I watch you go down the road where I know you endured it all for me. Amen.
I wonder, have you ever thought about how many times we change your mind? Or is that just me? Are you one of those people that think, oh yeah, that looks good, or that's nice, or I must do this, and then 2 or 3 minutes later you've changed your mind completely? I think we all go through that, changing from one thing to another. One day something's in, the next it's out. It's as if everything changes at the flip of a coin. We make up our mind just depending on how we're actually feeling. You know, people's loyalties change so easily these days. And you see it most often in professional sports. As teams become more successful, they take on even more fans. Now, these fans were once fans of a different team. But as their original team became less successful, certain fans jumped ship, so to speak, and became fans of the more successful team. They were after the glory. They were not real fans. And when we look at Palm Sunday and the story of Palm Sunday, the same people who were shouting Hosanna and were so hyped up on Palm Sunday in Jerusalem were shouting Crucify Him only 5 days later. Can people really be so fickle? You know, how can you be so excited for the coming of Jesus one day and 5 days later you're calling for him to be crucified? Of course they can. They can be fickle because we know we're fickle if we're totally honest. And as Jesus headed towards Jerusalem, the fame of this guy from Galilee had gone before him. This was the man who healed the sick, even raised the dead, and expectations would have been at fever pitch. It would have been electrifying. I want you to imagine this morning being in Jerusalem, waiting on Jesus, and asking ourselves, would we have been any different than the people of that day who shouted Hosanna and celebrated and soon afterwards called for him to be crucified? Think about that. If we had been there, what would we have done? Would we have followed the crowd or followed Jesus? You know, it's easy to shout Hosanna when things are going well, but a different story when everything's going wrong and not going the way you wanted them to go. We are tempted in these times to turn our backs and be ashamed of the cross and the man on it. Yet we can't just change how we identify with Christ based on our feelings and circumstances or trendy doctrines, because if we do, we're no better than that fickle crowd in the streets of Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. As long as it was about Jesus and what Jesus could do to make their lives better, they were happy to shout Hosanna. But as soon as it became about what they could do for him, it was either silence or it was crucify him. Again, like the flip of a coin, everything changed for the people in Jerusalem. We can so often be like that crowd, can't we? Even our silence can discredit our Lord, as we stand by and never utter a word. We don't want to offend anybody. Let's just keep quiet. Don't say anything. Don't mention Jesus. Silence questions who he really is, and really makes him nothing more than a sugar daddy. And when the sugar is gone, we no longer want to have anything to do with him. When he's not sweetening our lives, when we have to stand up for him, we tend to hide, keep quiet. How willing are you to follow Jesus if it requires taking up your cross and following him? Jesus told us there is a cost to discipleship. Are we ready for that? Are we ready to pay that cost? John writes in chapter 12 and verses 12 and 13, the next day the news that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem swept through the city. A large crowd of Passover visitors took palm branches and went down the road to meet him. They shouted, "Praise God! Blessings to the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel." That's what people were shouting on that day. Hail to the King of Israel. Jesus had a huge fan base on that day. A huge fan base who cheered him, who celebrated, who put palms on the road, who waved palms, they laid their cloaks on the road. The King was coming. The King of Israel was coming. Praise God. But just 5 days later, that fan base had deserted him. They'd left. Where were they? The same people who were praising him on Sunday would vote to put him to death on a cross on Good Friday. Jesus knew that. Jesus knew what was in their hearts. Just like today, he knows what's exactly in our hearts as we sit here, as we watch online. Let's not kid ourselves. Jesus knew it was going to be a bad week. Do you know the way on a Sunday night and you're going to bed and you know your schedule for the next week and you think, oh, this is going to be a bad week. There's just so much. This is going to be bad. My friends, our bad week pales into insignificance to the week that Jesus knew that lay ahead of him. He knew what was going to happen. And he would spend this last week knowing that not only the people of Jerusalem would call for his crucifixion, but he would be betrayed by one of his disciples. He would be denied by one of his closest friends. And finally, he knew that he would be totally abandoned by the rest of his disciples. And how should Jesus react, and how would Jesus react in this final week of his life? Would he throw a fit? That's what I asked. Why did he not throw a fit? Why did he not get in a real bad temper? You know, when everybody abandons you and leaves you, we don't feel like celebrating. Sure we don't? We don't feel like celebrating. We feel let down. Why did he not try to get back at those who would let him down? What would his final week be like? How would Jesus react? Scripture tells us that Jesus reacted in a very different way than probably any of us would do. On that final week, Jesus still washed his disciples' feet. Jesus still comforted his disciples. He still promised them the gift of the Holy Spirit. He still prayed for his disciples. He still prayed for all the believers and all people. He still had that Passover meal with his disciples. He drove the money changers out of the temple. He still taught at the temple. He still condemned religious leaders. Jesus knew his time had come, but there was still work to be done in this final week on earth. Jesus didn't use the last week of his life to serve himself, to try and make life a little bit better. He used it to serve others right up to the cross. You know, Jesus' entry into Jerusalem wasn't a planned event, really, like the 4th of July parade here. Social media didn't bring together these people who lined the streets. They came because they had heard of the things that Jesus had done, because people were so moved by his teaching. And they asked the question, could this be the Messiah? People's lives were actually changing. And they wondered, could this be the Messiah? They knew that people were being healed. Could this be the Messiah? People were beginning to shift their allegiance from the law that was being taught to Jesus, because they thought, maybe this could be the Messiah. As people witnessed miracles, people lined the streets because this was the Messiah. The King was coming. Jesus was passing through, riding on a donkey's colt. Could this be the Messiah they'd been waiting for? And they were shouting, Hosanna. And that word, Hosanna, in the context of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, simply meant, please save us. Every person who was lining that street was shouting, Hosanna, was asking Jesus to save them, but not realizing who he truly was. They thought he was going to save them from the Romans. Hosanna was a desperate cry for help, and didn't realize that the saving that needed to be done was within their own hearts and lives. That desperate cry to save me was coming from their heads, not from their hearts. The people lining the streets in Jerusalem before the crucifixion were desperate to be rescued. They were looking for Jesus to be that mighty deliverer who would free them from Roman oppression. They didn't understand their own prophetic teachings that the Messiah, Israel's hope, would first come as a suffering servant before he would come as a conquering king. They thought they would crown him, but Jesus knew different. Jesus knew they would kill him. Can you imagine the scenes in Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday and listening to those cries echoing through the streets for salvation. Please save us. There must have been such joy, such excitement. And now imagine 5 days later and hearing these words spoken about Jesus by the same people in John 19, verse 15. Away with him, they yelled. Away with him. Crucify him. What could have happened in those short 5 days that turned the people against Jesus? Is it possible that these people that shouted Hosanna on Sunday dispersed once Jesus was arrested? Is it possible that the crowd became disillusioned when they discovered that Jesus was not going to overthrow the Roman government? Is it possible that the people changed their loyalties just because of pressure from the religious leaders? From Hosanna to crucify. Such a difference. Today, for each one of us, we know that salvation was coming. But not in the person of a mighty conquering king, but in the person of an obedient servant who would be nailed to a cross, who would be placed in a tomb. But salvation would arrive 3 days later. Jesus obediently went to the cross to endure the salvation of those who would place their faith in him. This was God's plan. This was God's plan before time. Nothing was going to derail it or stop it. This is what was going to happen because mankind needed their lives restored and changed and healed and transformed and redeemed. So this story of Jesus Christ has taken us from Hosanna to crucify to a glorious hallelujah on Easter Sunday. What a day Easter Sunday is. What a celebration it is. How are we going to react to this Easter story? How are we going to react to the one who died for our sins? How are we going to react? Are we going to shout, save us? Or are we going to shout, crucify him? Or are we going to say nothing and just hide in the background? That's your decision. It's my decision how we respond to Jesus. When we cry out to him and say, save us, he will do that. Or will we just ignore him? It's a big question. What does Easter mean to us? What does this story and this journey to the cross mean to us? And please don't think we're any different than those people all those years ago in Jerusalem. Because we go with the flow. We'll go where the crowd are going. We'll not push against it. And you're standing among thousands and they're shouting, crucify him. What do you do? Do you wait till it all quietens down and go, oh, excuse me, I object. Don't crucify him. I object. We probably stay quiet because we don't want to be taken away. Jesus was willing to go and pay the full price for us because of love, out of love. A love that came from his Father to him. And he says to us today again, what are you shouting today? Are you shouting Hosanna? Will that continue through this week? Continue through the rest of your lives as we glorify God? Or will we just fall back into the crowd? just let things happen. Even his closest friends, his disciples, jumped ship. These people that had spent 3 years traveling with him, spent, it seems, every minute of every day together. When the chips were down, they were nowhere to be found. And I look at that and I think, at times I'm no different than what those disciples are. And that's not what God calls us to be. He calls us to be people who are brave, who are strong, who stand up for what's right, who will shout Hosanna and not be ashamed. Hosanna. Thank you. Hosanna to the King of Kings. Let that be emblazoned on our hearts and our lives, not just at Easter, but throughout the year. And may we lift him up, and may we celebrate next Sunday the risen Savior. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you that there had to be a Palm Sunday and a Good Friday so that we could celebrate Easter Sunday. We thank you that you didn't jump ship. We thank you that you journeyed the whole way to the cross, from that triumphal entry to the pain of a cross. You knew where your journey was leading and would take you, and you went there out of love for each one of us, for each person in this world. We have said it many times. We know that if we were the only person in this world, you would have still have died and hung on that cross and rose again just for me, for you. So, Lord, let us celebrate this great day next Sunday. Let's bring others with us. Let's get in that party mode, because Jesus broke free from a tomb. The chains were gone. New life had come. The Lord was risen. Praise his name. Hallelujah. Amen. What I'd like you to do is, we're going to sing a song called What a Beautiful Name. And I want us to use that as just our celebration of worship to our Jesus. And then when that song finishes, we're going to sing another song. And what I would love you to do is, during that last song, I'd like you to come up and I'd like you to put your palms at the foot of the cross. I'd like us to make a pathway, as if we were at the streets of Jerusalem, because our palms led to the cross. And as we lay them down at the cross, as you walk forward, think about the sacrifice that Jesus made, the journey that he was making. And I want you to ask yourself, what does that mean to you? Because unless it means something personal, we're just wasting our time. Jesus didn't die because he thought it was a good idea. He died to set us free. And as we walk to the cross and we lay our palms, just think about that, the sacrifice. And we should be able to go back to our seats with a skip in our step, because we know what Jesus did for us. So we're going to sing this first song, and just stay where you are, stand, and we'll sing this, and then I'll invite you to come forward. This is called What a Beautiful Name. Should be shouted from the rooftops. So please, as we sing this song, you can, the words will be up on the screen, you'll be able to sing it as you come up. But lay your palms, think about the price, and think about the journey to that cross.
Thank you.
us pray. You're the Lamb that was slain, and your blood washes us clean. You're the pure sacrifice. Let your life give us life. You're the Lamb. Let us go from here, knowing that we are washed clean by the blood of Jesus Christ. And that when we come to him and call Hosanna, save us, he says, you are saved, you are redeemed, you are loved. Now go and live in that love and that assurance of eternal life. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great week.